But transpersonal psychology in Britain is not very healthy.
In Germany also.
Yeah.
It's very, very on a low profile.
Yeah, yeah, it's not big.
Yeah. So, what is, when you are teaching people or working with people, what is your, if you have a goal, what is it?
Well, I actually work as a transpersonal psychotherapist.
Yes.
And my goal is to work with them on what they are ready to open up to by way of transpersonal experiences and so forth. And I've written several chapters on transpersonal psychotherapy and also transpersonal coaching. I think coaching is becoming much more important these days. Much more high profile. So that's what's happening.
Could you say, maybe for someone who's doing coaching and does not know anything about the transpersonal realm, what this is all about for in your understanding?
No, I think most coaches wouldn't bother. Wouldn't know
in anything. Germany, I guess a lot of even don't know the word transpersonal.
No, I think the there's a transpersonal. There is a coaching organization called the Association for Coaching, AC, and I'm a member of that. I'm an MAC.
Yes.
Some of the members of that are transpersonal, like Sir John Whitmore. Sir John Whitmore, and there's a woman who works with him as well, whose name I can't remember. And he's quite prominent in coaching. He's written a book on transpersonal coaching, I think. And he's very good. He's very good. And his wife, Diana Whitmore, is the head of the Psychosynthesis Institute in London. So there's a connection with psychosynthesis. And psychosynthesis, of course, is one of the main channels for transpersonal work all around the world.
I mean,
very big worldwide presence, in fact. And in London, there are four transpersonal Psychosynthesis Institute.
Oh, wow.
There's
really
a Psychosynthesis Institute. There's the Psychosynthesis and Education Trust. There's something.
Have you also been trained in psychosynthesis?
Me?
Yeah.
No.
No, it's not your field.
No, I'm quite interested, and I've spoken at the Psychosynthesis Institute in Stockholm.
Oh, yeah. Okay. On which topic?
Can't remember. So I'm and my supervisor is a psychosynthesis therapist. There's also another organization in London, which is interesting, called CCPE, Center for
Contemplation,
something,
psychology,
and anyway, the guy who runs that is a Sufi, or associated with Sufi. And he's that's another transpersonal organization.
What would you say is could be a direction or a goal for the transpersonal psychology in general in the future?
Well, I think just simply becoming better known.
Yeah. Okay.
Just simply more and more.
Yeah.
Nothing specific. Nothing special.
Yeah. Yeah.
because I think transpersonal psychology is quite well developed now. I mean, the volume came out recently, a big volume called the Wiley-Blackwell Handbook of Transpersonal Psychology. And it's very good. Mm-hmm. It's a very solid academic work. Which I quote constantly.
So it's really getting something like a force.
Yeah. No, I think it's quite healthy at the moment. Perhaps more healthy than humanistic psychology. Because humanistic psychology is going through a very funny period at the moment. I mean, if you look at the website of humanistic psychology in the States, it's almost non-functional.
Yes.
It's very weak.
I realized that.
Whereas it used to be very bright, and they produced this monthly magazine called Perspectives, which doesn't seem to exist anymore.
It's gone.
And they've all moved out of California and somewhere else now.
Yeah.
Not quite sure where. Anyway, it's very sad. That's very sad. But in England, we have actually held on to this super journal called Self and Society, which has recently been bought by Routledge, the publisher.
Yeah.
And they are now publishing it, and no financial responsibility for anybody else at all, so that's brilliant. Very, very good.
It's good.
But I think there is an important connection
between
humanistic psychology and transpersonal psychology, and we shouldn't forget that.
Yeah, of course. Did you know Sutic? Anthony Sutic, did you know him?
No, I never met him.
I find him, he seems to me an interesting person, but you don't find much about him.
No.
Because he hasn't written...
he was always kind of second to Maslow.
But he was, I think he was a remarkable person.
I think he was in a wheelchair, I think.
Yes.
Paraplegic guy, very, very active, I think, in the origins of humanistic psychology.
Yes.
But I don't know what happened to him later at all. No idea. He's certainly not around now. He must have died, I guess.
I guess he died in really early.
Yes, he wasn't in good health.
But I guess he did a good job. He worked all from home.
Absolutely.
In his wheelchair.
He did a great job. First of all, he founded the, or helped to found the Journal of Humanistic Psychology. And then secondly, he helped to found the Journal of Transpersonal Psychology. Great achievement. Great achievement. Because both of those still exist.
Yes, yes.
I think they've both been taken over by publishers now. I'm not sure.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, wonderful.
And there's a lovely girl, lovely woman actually, in charge of the Journal of Transpersonal Psychology. Marie Boucouvoulas. She's very, very good.
What do you think about this? I guess Maslow met with Groff, I saw in a film somewhere, and they were very close related to this perinatal matrices Groff found out. What do you think about this? Do you want to say?
Well, good. And I don't know much about it.
Yeah, okay.
but I'm a great fan of Rolf. I think he's a terrific guy.
Yes.
No, no, good work.
What helped me a lot was your mentioning of the different levels of the consciousness today. It was like, I know that Wilbur has written a lot about it, but I don't know why I was always dancing around the bush, and the bush was Wilbur.
I mean, Wilbur is controversial in a lot of ways, but he's a good map maker.
Yeah.
It's a very usable map for therapists, because it's simple enough for a therapist to understand.
Yeah, something that's not understandable, for the mind.
And there's all kinds of complicated... there's a guy called Mike Daniels in England, who's a very complicated map of the whole field of spirituality and so forth. I can't make sense of it at all. I don't know where I am with this fucking map. Stupid. But Wilbur's map is very clear, very simple. Maybe it's oversimplified, I don't know. But it's very usable anyway, as you saw today.
Yeah.
I can use it.
Yeah.
And people understand it, and people can follow it.
Yes.
With no difficulty,
It seems to me a very as if you have distilled it through your lifetime experiences, and it was very on the point.
I think so. Why should it be complicated?
Yeah, this is nice.
So what are you going to do with this material?
The first part is for my PhD. I will write down a few insights. Maybe because I'm traveling seven countries this year, and it will be presented on the NLP World Congress next year in Egypt. I will present some cuts there, and then maybe I will make afterwards a short documentary about it.
Do you like NLP?
I always made a big circle around NLP because I said I'm a hypnotherapist, I'm a gestalt therapist, and I'm a systemic coach. So I don't need NLP. But then I made a master training in NLP, and I think it depends on who you do it with. I found some interesting stuff also.
But there's a lot of good things in NLP. I'm not, but they are a very pretentious bunch of people who overestimate their amazing brilliance. And I don't like their use of trance either.
What do you don't like there?
Well, I think they make too much use of trance when they don't need to. I think almost everything that you can do with trance, you can do without trance.
This is interesting.
I mean, for example, if you do a guided fantasy, I say, okay, close your eyes, and now you're in a meadow surrounded by flowers and so forth. You don't need a trance for that. You just do it. You don't need a trance.
Or you are in a trance.
It's funny, I went to a hypnotist meeting once, and I wanted to explore this thing of trance. I said, I want to volunteer. And so this woman came forward, and I said, okay, now, can you tell the difference when you're in a trance and not in a trance? And she said, no, I'm in a trance all the time.
Yes.
I couldn't go any further than my demonstration.
Funny, yeah. It's an everyday trance, huh?
Yeah.
I'm sure I call it detrance or dehypnosis.
Yeah.
When people come to me and want hypnosis, I say, no, we have to do dehypnosis because you are in a trance. And this is what we mostly do with meditation, to dehypnotize. I think this is my opinion.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Because the guy maybe who smokes, he consciously knows. It hurts him, it stings, it costs a lot of money, and he still does it. Because of this, he's in a trance, high focus.
Yes, somebody called the way that most people live, the consensus trance.
Yes, good. It shall start.
I think that's fair.
He coined the term consensus trance, shall start.
Who was that?
Charles Tart, Charlie Tart.
Trance?
Tart.
Oh, Charles Tart. Oh, did he?
Yeah.
No, he's good. I like him.
He's good. Yeah, wonderful. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good. I hope it works well for you.
Yeah, fine.